Good afternoon. Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus? The next item of business is portfolio questions on the Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. If a member wishes to request a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button or indicate so in the chat function by entering the letter R during the relevant question. I call question number one, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what preparations are being made for holding an independence referendum in the first half of this Parliament.
Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson.
On the 7th of September 2021, the First Minister announced as part of the programme for government that the Scottish Government will work to ensure that a legitimate and constitutional referendum can be held within its parliamentary term, and if the COVID crisis is over, within the first half of the parliamentary term itself. Since the announcement in the PFG, work has begun to scope what will be required to take this commitment forward and to provide the people of Scotland the information they will need in order that they can make an informed choice about Scotland's future.
Kenneth Gibson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Whilst independence supporters understand the need to wait until we are clear of COVID, the chaos and ineptitude of the UK's shambolic government, one clearly determined to undermine the existing devolved settlement, increases the urgency of Scotland's need to re-emerge as an independent sovereign state equal among nations. Will the Cabinet Secretary commit to making a statement to Parliament as soon as we are through the pandemic on the roadmap to an independence referendum and beyond?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'd be more than happy to make a statement to Parliament on this matter. The case for independence is a strong one. This government will present it openly, frankly, and with confidence and ambition. An independent Scotland would have the power to make different choices, including about how we manage public health challenges with different budgetary options, and could make choices best suited to Scotland's interests. The Scottish Government has a clear mandate to hold a referendum, and it's the people of Scotland who will have the right to determine the future of Scotland.
Supplementary from Donald Cameron, who's joining us remotely.
Thank you. Given the serious concerns around the Omicron variant, does the Cabinet Secretary agree that the very last thing we should be doing today is discussing a second independence referendum, and further, that all available financial resources currently earmarked for referendum planning should be immediately reprioritised and used in our collective effort against COVID?
Cabinet Secretary.
No, I don't agree with the Conservative front bench spokesman. He, as is so often the case, together with his colleagues, ignores the result of the Scottish Parliament election. The people of Scotland elected an SNP-led government, elected with a mandate to hold a referendum. And in addition to the work that we are clearly doing, the number one priority in battling the COVID pandemic, we have the full panoply of government work that we need to pursue. Part of that is making the preparations for the referendum that will take place when the time is right and the COVID pandemic is past.
And a supplementary from Karen Adam, who is joining us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. When I stood for election in May this year, I stood on a manifesto commitment to hold an independence referendum. I was elected by the people of Banffshire and Buchan Coast who gave me this mandate. People want that choice presented to them. People in the North East have been putting money into the UK coffers for a long time and have now been hammered by the UK government's damaging Brexit and mediocre drop-in-the-ocean investment, which does not come close to what they have paid in for decades. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that the people of the North East are entitled to choose who decides their future, particularly given the circumstances around a fair and just transition?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I do agree with my colleague. The member is entirely correct. The people of the northeast of Scotland and Scotland as a whole have a right to exercise a choice about independence, and the Scottish Government is committed to supporting and facilitating a just transition. This is demonstrated by the 10-year £500 million scheme, the Just Transition Fund for the North East and Moray, which was announced earlier this year, and we asked the UK Government to match that ambition, which to date they have not. In October, the UK Government also failed to award the green light to the cluster led by the Acorn project at St Fergus. It's extremely disappointing for the North East. Currently, the Scottish Government does not hold all the necessary legislative and regulatory levers to support the cluster, as they are retained by the UK Government. This decision jeopardises the opportunities to deliver a just transition in our energy sector and for Scotland to achieve our ambitions. It must be up to the people of Scotland to decide how Scotland is governed.
Question number three, Rhoda Grant, who is joining us remotely. Ms Grant, could you please start your question from the beginning, because we did not hear it. Thank you.
Apologies, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support it provides to creative industries in rural areas, including in relation to young people wishing to pursue a career in this sector.
Minister Jenical Ruth.
The Scottish Government supports the creative industries in rural areas through a range of activities delivered through our enterprise and skills agencies, as well as on direct activity. This support includes Expo North, the year-round support programme for the Highlands and Islands, and skills training funded by the Scottish Government's National Transition Training Fund. Young people also receive mentoring and support through Level Up Digital and the TVV programme. From next year, support will also be available through the £20 million Rural Entrepreneurs Fund.
Rhoda Grant.
The Inverness Creative Academy WASP Studios provides affordable studio accommodation to those in the creative industries. However, there are very few such opportunities throughout the Highlands and Islands. In light of rural depopulation and the fact that the creative sector is hit particularly hard by the effects of COVID, how does the Scottish Government plan to encourage similar ventures to ensure that young people working in creative industries are not forced to leave the area to pursue their careers?
Minister.
I thank Rhoda Grant for her question. She raises a number of important points, but primarily with regard to, I think, the Inverness Trade Academy, the example that she's provided was really quite an important one, and I'm keen to have a bit more of a conversation with Rhoda Grant about that work and how we might be able to better support that activity. She mentioned some of the impacts with regard to the creative sector, who are right now, of course, suffering from the very real impacts of the Omicron variant in terms of the events sector, but more broadly, the culture sector, who have been one of the worst hit in terms of the pandemic impacts. So I will certainly take that away as a good example of the work that we are currently focused on, which is on helping the sector to recover from the impacts of the pandemic.
And supplementary, Bill Kidd.
Yes, thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Minister, Scotland's a sought-after destination for film and television production, so it's important that we continue to invest in developing the sector. On that basis, can the Minister outline how the funding allocated in the Scottish Budget will support the sector to grow?
Minister.
This funding will help to build the skills, talent, support system and studio infrastructure to enable our film and TV industry to capitalise on unprecedented interest in production in Scotland, but it will also further develop a sustainable creative economy. The new £11.9 million Kelvin Hall Studio, which the Cabinet Secretary announced last week, funded by Scottish Government and Glasgow City Council, is a prime example of the confidence that we have in Scotland's fast-growing screen sector. Investing in Scottish skills and talent, opening up new opportunities, is the best way to ensure our storytelling and creativity drive what's on the screen and representing us authentically here and also around the world.
Question number four, Joe Fitzpatrick, who is joining us remotely.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the steps that it's taking to strengthen Scotland's international relationships.
Cabinet Secretary.
Scotland is a proudly internationalist nation and embraces opportunities to strengthen our international relationships. Our new global affairs framework will be grounded in a values-based approach and will set out the basis which the Scottish Government will prioritise our international activity. Our international offices enhance Scotland's international reputation and create domestic opportunities. We've plans to strengthen our office in Brussels and open offices in both Copenhagen and Warsaw in the coming years. We will also continue to use our growing International Development Fund and enhance Climate Justice Fund to work with partners in the Global South.
Joe Fitzpatrick.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Maintaining close relationships with our friends in Europe and across the world is integral to building a stronger and fairer, more prosperous Scotland. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide a little bit more of an update on the work of Scotland's international offices in promoting Scottish interests overseas?
Cabinet Secretary.
Our new offices in Copenhagen and Warsaw will promote Scotland's interests and expertise in the Nordic and Central European regions, attracting investment and supporting the exchange of knowledge and of best practice. Our international presence creates domestic opportunities, broadens our horizons, attracts investment, and ultimately benefits the people of Scotland. Our policies and actions abroad will be consistent with our focus on fairness and inclusion at home. The programme for government emphasises our commitment to reviewing our approach to future policy and economic engagement with a view to enhancing Scotland's global reach and Scotland's presence.
A supplementary from Carol Mochen, who is joining us remotely.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that the US blockade on Cuba, which has been imposed for over five decades, must now be ended to allow the Cuban economy to recover from the pandemic and trade freely with key markets?
Cabinet Secretary, I think that might be a wee bit wide of the question, but I note your enthusiasm to respond, so please do.
Always pleased to respond. Obviously, I think the normalisation of relations with Cuba is something that has over recent years been pursued even by US administrations with the opening of trade, the ability of Cubans, of Cuban exiles to file remittances to relatives in Cuba. I'm at the front of the queue to acknowledge the fact that the human rights record of the Cuban state, which is run by a one-party government, is not something that we would seek to support. However, I do stand in support of improved relations with Cuba while supporting the importance of human rights on that island.
And supplementary from Claire Adamson, who is joining us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. An integral part of fostering good relations is building trust with international partners. So the decision of the Home Office to force EU citizens with pre-settled status to reapply for their rights to live and work in the UK is an affront and potentially yet another breach of the withdrawal agreement that the UK Government signed up to. What engagement has the Scottish Government had with the Home Office regarding the impact of this decision and what it will mean for EU citizens who have made Scotland their home?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government have always been clear that European Union citizens should not have to apply to retain the rights that they enjoyed when the UK was a member state of the European Union. The UK Government should have chosen a declaratory statement rather than force people to suffer the indignity of applying to the EU settlement scheme. We've also consistently said that all successful applicants to the EUSS should be granted permanent settled status rather than the less secure pre-settled status. We fully appreciate and support the position taken by the Independent Monitoring Authority and call on the UK Government to remove the requirement for pre-settled status holders to make a second stressful application to the EUSS.
Question number five, Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action is taken to support the promotion of cultural assets connected to Robert Burns in Dumfries and Galloway.
Minister.
The Scottish Government has provided a £47,000 Museum Development Fund grant through Museums Gallery Scotland this year to redevelop and relaunch the future museum website, which will benefit the Robert Burns Centre and Robert Burns House. We've also provided a total of £28,941 of funding to the Robert Burns Ellisland Trust over the past 2 years and £30,000 to support the Big Burns Supper Festival in Dumfries in 2022 through Events Scotland. In addition, Visit Scotland and Events Scotland offer a range of promotional support to Burns-related attractions and events throughout Dumfries and Galloway to encourage tourism.
Oliver Mundell.
I thank the Minister for that answer. The calls to do more to capitalise on the cultural value of Burns are nothing new. Back in October 2019, we saw the publication of the Scottish Government-funded Pittock Report following sustained calls from our former colleague, Joe McAlpine, whose contribution on this issue is much missed in the Chamber. Can I ask what's been done to implement its recommendations, particularly Recommendation 5, which highlights the opportunities to promote a more integrated Burns Trail and the significant untapped potential of Ellisland Farm and Museum?
Minister.
I thank Oliver Mundell for his supplementary question. As he alluded to, in May 2018, we commissioned Murray Pittock at the Centre for Robert Burns Studies at Glasgow University to produce the report that he alluded to. And the report, of course, found that Robert Burns is worth in excess of £200 million annually to the Scottish economy, largely through tourism, but also in terms of food and drink and culture. And it also talks about the brand value of almost £140 million annually for Scotland attributable to Robert Burns. With regard to the specifics of Mr Mundell's question, he asked if the government can do more with regard to Robert Burns and the impact on the economy, and bases that on Murray Pittock's report. I'm more than happy to meet with Mr Mundell on this. He also alludes to Joe McAlpine, my former colleague's contribution in the chamber on this, and I know it was an issue on which she was driving very much so as a MSP formerly, but I know that she's now very much involved in the Ellisland Trust additionally. So if Mr Mundell would like to meet with me and Ms McAlpine, I'd be more than happy to address some of the key actions that came out as a result of that report.
Question number 6, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it works with overseas partners in helping tackle COVID-19 and support a global recovery.
Minister.
Since the start of the pandemic, the Scottish Government has allocated £3.5 million from our international development budget for COVID support in our partner countries of Malawi, Rwanda and Zambia. In addition, in September, we donated £11.2 million worth of surplus NHS Scotland PPE kit to those three partner countries in Africa, providing £250,000 from our International Development Fund to contribute again towards the transportation costs of those materials. Next financial year, we will increase our International Development Fund by a further £1.5 million to £11.5 million, specifically for initiatives responding to COVID-19 in our three African partner countries.
Brian Whittle.
Can I thank the Minister for that answer? And I think after announcing, as she says, the further funding for overseas aid last month, can the Minister outline what, if anything, more has been planned to help supplement the efforts to vaccinate those in our partner countries in light of the rising cases as a result of the Omicron variant?
Minister.
I thank Mr Whittle for his question. I don't know if he was in the chamber 2 weeks ago when I gave a statement specifically focused on actually our COVID response to our partner countries. The Scottish Government's response in terms of the COVID-19 pandemic with regard to our partner countries has been largely focused on preparing our partner countries for vaccine rollout, not on the vaccine rollout itself. That is because we are not members, of course, of the COVAX programme, so there are a number of challenges there. But we did last year conduct a review into our international development offer. And the reason that I conducted that review, or instructed that review rather, was because of the new reality that COVID had presented in terms of our international development rollout. So we awarded last year, for example, £2 million to UNICEF to help with their COVID-19 response, including vaccine preparedness that I spoke to and also on delivery. More recently, I visited Glasgow University along with colleagues from KwaZulu University of Health Sciences in Malawi to learn about some of the work that we're funding with them, which is focused on genomic sequencing capacity in Malawi. And that project brings together the expertise of Kamuzu University, but also of the University of Glasgow, to impact on the COVID-19 pandemic to the benefit of both Malawian and Scottish populations in terms of learning about how the virus intersects with the vaccine in our partner countries. And the primary objective will be to determine the magnitude of the immune response to COVID-19 vaccines in the Malawian population. So whilst we are not directly involved in vaccination, I hope it will give Mr Whittle some reassurance that we are absolutely involved in vaccine preparedness, but also in that wider learning around about how the virus is developing in our partner countries, which we know is absolutely crucial in terms of what we're facing right now with regard to new variants that are appearing in the form of Omicron.
Faisal Chowdhury, supplementary.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Taking the fight against climate change must always be the priority for us to support the global recovery. In April, UNHCR released data showing that 21.5 million people have been displaced by climate change-related disasters since 2010, pointing out, in addition to sudden disaster, climate change is a complex cause of food and water shortage, as well as difficulties in accessing natural resources, with statistics shows there could be a rise of over 200,000 in the years to come. This displaced people and refugees are also doubly hit with COVID-19 outbreaks as well, with limited access to healthcare and vaccination.
Mr. Chowdhury, could we have a question, please?
What steps is the Scottish Government taking to prevent further tragedies and supporting refugees in need?
Thank you. Minister.
I thank Faisal Chowdhury for his question. He's right, of course, to point to the impacts of climate change on developing countries in particular. He will know that primarily the Scottish Government's response is through the Climate Justice Fund, which sits with my colleague Mary McCallum. But nonetheless, I think it important to point out the Scottish Government recently increased our Climate Justice Fund and additionally have also increased our funding with regard to loss and damage with a new fund specifically available for our partner countries on tackling the impacts of climate change with regard to loss and damage. In terms of how we can respond to pandemics, or I suppose I think he spoke to some of the challenges that climate change presents in our partner countries, we primarily offer assistance through our Humanitarian Emergency Fund. He may be aware that we recently announced funding earlier this week, actually, with regard to the rollout of support in Afghanistan, which is, of course, facing a huge challenge at this moment in time. So primarily that work is addressed through the Humanitarian Emergency Fund, but specifically on the Climate Justice Fund, there is more potentially of a link with Mary McCallum's ministerial responsibilities in that respect. Nonetheless, I think it's important that we have policy coherence on these issues, and I'm meeting actually with Ms McCallum in January to discuss how we link up our international development work with our Climate Justice Fund.
A supplementary, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the compassionate approach to international cooperation development that the Scottish Government has pursued in recent years. Can the Minister provide any further detail as to how Scotland's ambition to enhance its reputation as a good global citizen will be served by the 2022-23 Scottish Budget?
Minister.
International development is a key part of Scotland's global contribution within the international community. It encompasses our core values, historical and contemporary, of fairness and equality. The increase to our International Development Fund from £10 million to £11.5 million next financial year, in contrast, of course, to the UK Government, who are cutting development funding, is a clear indication of this Government's ambition to further enhance Scotland's reputation as a good global citizen.
Question number 7, Tess White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the investment it's making in Scotland's cultural infrastructure.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm very pleased to give the opportunity to do so. The Scottish Government is investing £14.2 million in the current financial year in a range of capital projects, including the Scottish National Gallery, refurbishment and the Museum of Flight. As announced on the 9th of December, we are committing a further £2 million to support cultural recovery in the museums and gallery sector. That includes £1 million for the Cranog Centre and a further £1 million for the sector to adapt to the challenges of the pandemic. The 2022-23 budget published on the 9th of December allocates £30 million to my portfolio for capital expenditure supporting a range of infrastructure projects.
Tess White.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The 19th century A-listed Aberdeen Art Gallery recently won the 2021 Doolan Award for Scotland's Best Building after a transformational redevelopment project. It has, however, experienced significant damage to its exterior caused by urban gull population. Cabinet Secretary, in the North East, gulls don't just attack people. Their droppings are a persistent problem. Can I ask you, please, Cabinet Secretary, what action is the Scottish Government taking with local authorities and Historic Environment Scotland to conserve our building heritage and protect it from pests like these?
Cabinet Secretary.
As somebody who lived in Aberdeen for 4 years while studying in that great city, I understand the dangers that the member is describing. I also recognise the point that she's making about the challenge to the built infrastructure that we have, both within the stock under Historic Environment Scotland, but more generally. Given the specific question that she's asked without advance notice, I'd be happy to write back to her so that she has the fullest information that I can provide. And I appreciate that she and colleagues across the House will want to ensure that as much as can be possibly done to protect the built environment and historic environment that we have right across Scotland.
And supplementary, Sarah Boyack.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Cabinet Secretary, in the light of the new restrictions which were announced after last week's budget, will the Scottish Government commit to ensure that future funding criteria do not require venues and organisations to exhaust the reserves, given that they'll be critical for enabling the sector to get through the next few months and to rebuild for the future?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I welcome the opportunity given by Sarah Boyack through her question to briefly comment on the situation that we currently find ourselves in? We're in a very fast-moving situation given the Omicron variant of the COVID-19 pandemic. And in government, we are doing everything that we possibly can do within the constraints of the devolution settlement and finance to find the resources in place that we would wish to have to support the culture and art sector. Are there lessons that can be learned coming out of the pandemic in terms of how finances can be managed in a process through a serious challenge as we are currently living through? There is no doubt that there are lessons that can be learned, but I can assure her that I, that Jenny Gilruth, that colleagues in the Scottish Government are doing everything that we can do to try and secure the funding to support the culture and arts sector as we get through the pandemic.
Thank you. And question number 8, Claire Baker, who is joining us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it is engaging with and investing in the live performance sector to support its recovery.
Minister.
Since the start of the pandemic, the Scottish Government has provided £175 million of financial support to the culture, heritage and events sector. This recognises the significant impact that the pandemic has had and continues to have on the live performance sector. We are committed to working with the sector and our public bodies to support the sector's recovery. We've also continued to engage with the national performing companies and commercial music stakeholders.
Claire Baker.
I thank the Minister for that response. Since I submitted this question last week, the situation has changed from recovery to crisis. The income from the festive season is particularly important for the live performance sectors. Already, the Byre Theatre in St Andrews has halted its panto as well as festive film screenings. Refunds are being issued, but these costs will need to be covered. I appreciate the current situation is very challenging, but what is the Minister's understanding of compensation for closures and cancellations, whether that is support from government or from insurance policies that can support the sector, and what discussions is she currently engaged in?
Minister.
I thank Claire Baker for her very timely question. She's absolutely right to point to some of the very real challenges around live performance, particularly in terms of where the culture sector currently finds itself. The first point I think that is important is that to remember the culture sector did not fully recover from the last impact of the last lockdown. So in May of 2020, the GDP for the arts, culture and recreation sector had decreased by 56% below pre-pandemic levels. And indeed, the sector has still not fully recovered, with the latest statistics for September of this year showing that GDP for the sector was 12% lower than pre-pandemic levels compared to just 1% lower for the economy overall. And while the sector currently remains open, I am particularly alive to the challenge around audience confidence. I met on Tuesday with the Federation of Scottish Theatre and yesterday with the Scottish Commercial Music Industry Task Force, and the Cabinet Secretary will be meeting with stakeholders later this afternoon. As Ms Baker will know, the First Minister confirmed on Tuesday that further funding will be forthcoming to this end. However, there is a limit to that support, and it's also important to remember that the arts and cultural organisations in Scotland have still not received the full amount of outstanding culture consequentials promised to the sector in March, unlike in England, of course. Now, in fact, as the Scottish commercial music industry told me yesterday, cultural organisations in England can still apply to the Arts Recovery Fund until the end of January. Now, I don't begrudge organisations and venues accessing this funding in England. All I ask is that the Treasury reimburses the Scottish cultural sector on an equal basis. And with regard to Ms Baker's questions on compensation and closure, I hope that gives her some reassurance that we are doing all that we can as Scottish Government at this moment in time to look at what additional funding might be available for the sector. But there will be a limit, and we really do need the UK Government to step up with those outstanding consequentials which are due to the Scottish cultural sector.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions, and there'll be a very short pause before we move on to the next item of business. Thank you.